In this section, we're going to be slicing and dicing matrices as we describe how matrix-matrix multiply can be thought of in different ways. And in order to do that, we're going to establish some notation first. Here we have a concrete example of an arbitrary matrix. Let's call it X. I guess it's not arbitrary because it's a specific one. And here we have a vector X instead. And if you look carefully in the notes, what you will notice is that we always use an uppercase letter for the matrix, and we use a lowercase letter for a vector. Now, often we will want to think of our matrix as consisting of individual entries, but we want to abstract away from the specific entries. We want to sort of talk about an arbitrary entry in X. And when we do that, we view matrix X as consisting of its entries, and we use a lowercase Greek letter, chi, because this is X. Chi is the Greek letter that best corresponds to the Roman letter X. And then we index as that as 0, 0, chi 0, 1, and so forth, and then chi 1, 0, chi 1, 1, and so forth. Now what's going on here? Roman letter, uppercase letter X, Greek lowercase letter chi to represent its entries. You see chi, then you should think, oh, that must be an entry of matrix X. If it's indexed with an I and a J index. Obviously, if this were matrix A, then the corresponding Greek letter might be alpha, and we would have alpha 0, 0, alpha 0, 1, etc. Now, similarly, it may be that we want to talk about entries in vector X, in which case we would say X consists of the entries chi 0, chi 1, and so forth. And what you notice is that here we only use one index, and therefore when you see chi 1, you will almost always think, oh, that must be an element in a vector X. Sometimes you use it a little bit differently, but most of the time in context you'll recognize this. Now, often it will become convenient to think of matrix X as consisting of its columns. In that case, we say that X can be partitioned into its columns. Oops, I almost made a mistake. X0, X1 through Xn minus 1 if it has n columns. Now what's going on there? Notice that each column in the matrix is actually itself a vector, so we use the lowercase letter X to represent it. And then we can distinguish the different columns by putting a subscript on it that indicates which column it is. Now, sometimes we will want to view a matrix X by its rows. In that case, it might be tempting to say, that's equal to X0, X1 through Xn minus 1, like such. Now there's a problem with that, because in our notation, a lowercase letter is always used for a vector, and our vectors are always column vectors. So this really, to me, would indicate a column vector on top of a column vector on top of a column vector, and that's not what we're trying to accomplish here. Now notice that if you take a column vector and you transpose it, you end up with a row vector. So we can indicate that these are actually rows by putting a transpose as part of the symbols that represent these rows. But then you still have a question of, is this really the first column of X that we happen to have put on its side? Or is this a different vector from the first column of X? And when it's important to be able to distinguish that, what we do is we put a tilde on top to make that absolutely clear. Anyway, keep this notation in mind as we go through the entire course, because we try to be very consistent with this. So here we used X sort of as the generic matrix or the generic vector. In our discussions, we will be dealing with matrices A, B, and C. And then the lowercase letters for denoting vectors will be A, B, and C. And the lowercase letters from the Greek alphabet that we will use to go with A, B, and C will be alpha, beta, and gamma. So the good news is you don't need to worry about knowing the entire Greek alphabet. You only need to remember alpha, beta, and gamma. And as a matter of fact, you've already seen this in a lot of the material that we've covered so far.